Final Fantasy VIII holds a special place in my heart. Not that I would say it's the best Final Fantasy ever made, it's just my personal favorite. And that's probably because it was my first Final Fantasy. I mean, you know, everyone likes their first, right? Except for my girlfriend. A little while back, I was thinking to myself how as a kid, I used to believe that only three sorceresses can exist at any one time, but I don't remember why I believe this, so I had to get to researching. If there is one thing Final Fantasy VIII is universally known for, is its unique to borderline nonsensical writing. Not to say it's all bad though, I mean, some of it's truly beautiful. In fact, that reminds me of a little story before we continue on with the topic at hand. So we're joined by my friend Chris here, who represents Shinra Survival Corp over on Instagram. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good, Hunter. How about yourself?
Not so bad. I wanted to tell the people our Final Fantasy VIII story for when we were down on the island. You gonna help me with that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I can help you with that.
All right, so let's start it off. A friend and I were down on the island in BC, and we were walking along the docks with these two girls we were trying to hook up with. Okay.
Yeah.
I remember they were both good looking, right? Maybe?
Yeah.
We had just finished tuning up a homeless dude who we thought we'd be friends with until he told us to suck his dick and made a move on the girls we were with.
Oh, wait. Who's this guy? this is another homeless guy that we're going to have problems with because we'd already had an issue.
A couple of times. There's a lot of homeless on the island.
Yeah.
I don't know. Did they swim?
Talking to him, and it was suddenly like, okay, like he seems kind of normal for just a random guy you find in the middle of the night.
For a guy who's hanging out by boats at midnight.
Really quickly, like, oh, he's making some real stupid comments to the girls that are with us.
There's a great picture of the three of us because we all thought we were friends. And then, like you said, all of a sudden he's like, these guys are my friends. Then them's my girlfriends. Yeah. And he just all of a sudden kicks it up like, you know, hey, you want to see Jesus? Get on your knees, ladies. Let me suck on my cross. What?
It was so out of left field, just kind of like,
fucking right.
Oh, hey, he's not that bad. And then he's just like, yeah, get on your knees.
Somehow us fighting the homeless guy in the name of cheap pussy brought up the love triangle story from Final Fantasy VIII of Rain, Julia, and Laguna. And we were really breaking down every detail. I mean, to the point where even the chicks we were with mentioned,
oh, wow, like, what TV show is this?
Followed by an extremely loud hiss of their vaginas drying up as we explained it was from a video game.
And it was so quick. Like, as soon as they heard game, it was just like, oh, out the window. Get your nerd shit out of here.
But thank God we had each other, so we just 69'd in the bathtub at the end of the night.
Yeah, most of those times out there were one disappointment to another, so, you know, we just found shelter in each other's company.
Yeah, well, bros before hoes, when the hoes, you know, don't exist. So with that said, I like to think I have a pretty good grasp on the story and the lore of Final Fantasy VIII until I started doing my research, and then I realized I had missed a major portion of the plot, including really the major plot itself, just completely slipped me by somehow. I began my research believing that only three sorceresses can exist at any one time. I believed this because in the game, you interact with Adia, Adele, and Altamisia with no mention of any other sorceresses, until Adia gives her powers for Anoa, which still keeps the count at three current sorceresses. The obvious problem with that line of thinking, though, is that Altamisia isn't from current time, and thus shouldn't play into the current limitations. There is also the fact that nowhere does it actually specify only three can exist at once. And all of that is before we even begin talking about Ellen's time-traveling mind powers, Selfie's apocalyptic ending powers, or Fujin's cock-softening powers. So before we get into the information that I was unaware of, let's recap what we do know going forward. Because after all, like I said, Final Fantasy VIII, little abstract. So let's all get on the same page here. So we start this off with Sorceress Adia, a.k.a. Adia Kramer, a.k.a. the Matron. She inherited her powers from an unnamed sorceress at the young age of just 5 years old. She would later go on to marry Sid Kramer, a.k.a. Robin Williams. And together, they would open an orphanage to take in children who were orphaned thanks to the sorceress war that was being fought between the Vinzerdeling-led Galbadia and the sorceress Adele-ruled Esser. After losing his mother at birth, Squall, our main character, was sent to live at Sorceress Adia's orphanage, along with Ellen, who he viewed as an older sister. Ellen was living in Windhill with Squall's mother, Rain, after losing her own appearance in Sorceress Adele's raids on Windhill. Raids which were conducted with the sole goal of kidnapping Ellen back to Esser to utilize her unique time-traveling consciousness powers, which she simply calls Connect. Now, we've mentioned Sorceress Adele numerous times. She was a tyrannical leader of Esser. She is most noted for being brutal in her ways and absolutely eludes dommy-mommy energy. Just saying. Squall's father, Laguna, would later successfully go on to lead a rebellion to stop Sorceress Adele by sealing her away. Sorceress Adele would remain that way until she was released many years later by Renoa Hartley. Renoa Hartley is the daughter of Laguna's ex-love interest, Julia Hartley, and General Carraway of the Galbadian army. She would go on to fight Sorceress Adia in the clash between Balam Garden and Galbadia Garden, where Renoa would inadvertently inherit Sorceress Adia's powers. Once she became a sorceress from the future called Altamisia was now able to enter into her subconscious and control her actions. It is through this possession that Renoa would release Sorceress Adele from her tomb later on. After releasing Sorceress Adele, Renoa would later be apprehended and eventually junctioned to Sorceress Adele, who Squall and his allies, all members of Sorceress Adia's orphanage, go on to defeat in battle. We've mentioned Sorceress Altamisia a couple times, which is appropriate, as she is the primary antagonist and final boss of the game, even though you don't meet her face to face till the end of the game. Altamisia comes from the far distant future by using her time-based sorceress powers along with technology based on Ellen's powers. Her goal is to compress time so she can rule over the world across space and time, thus making her the greatest ruler of them all. So with that all said, what did I miss? What did I get wrong? Let's find out. I fired up Google, safe search, always off, and discovered I was wrong about the number of sorceresses just being 3 at any one time. I was also wrong about what actually constitutes a sorceress, and I even found out I was ignorant of how sorceress came to be, even though it's mentioned in-game. After 2 decades of playing this game, I'd missed some pretty major plot elements, but I wasn't the only one. How many sorceresses can exist at one time in Final Fantasy VIII?
From what I remember, it was only supposed to be like one at a time.
How are sorceresses made?
Oh, I don't remember.
Right.
Shit, I really don't remember, man.
No worries.
That's a big part of the story.
Well, this is it. So it's tricky, isn't it? So let's start getting to some of these answers here. And to start off, what is a sorceress? A sorceress is a female human who has inherited magical powers from another sorceress. They receive these magical powers via a process called embodiment, where a woman with magic potential is given the powers from a dying sorceress. It is said that a sorceress must pass on her powers before her death, as being powerless is the only way for them to rest in peace. Although the consequences of not passing on the powers is never explained in game, and I don't accept fan fiction for answers. Now, Final Fantasy VIII style story problem number one. How did Adia pass her powers to Renoa without dying? Well, we are told that in extremely rare circumstances, a near death will also force the sorceress to pass on her powers. And thus, that absolute ass-kicking we gave her in Galbadia Garden was enough to force her to enact embodiment. Well, story problem number two. If Renault inherited Adia's powers, how come she doesn't throw ice shards like Adia did? Well, that is because that every time a sorceress's powers are passed on, they become weaker. Although, no other detail is given, and a diminishing of power as much as seen between Adia and Renoa would lead me to believe there will be no powers to pass on very soon. Adia's got powers for days, you know, she's like a big boss for the first half of the game. Renoa, at the end of the game, is, what is she? She got no powers. You know? When she could fly a little bit with her wings. Boring! It also is never stated anywhere that the exact type of sorceress abilities will be passed on. So when I talk about unique sorceress abilities, examples in-game are such as like Adia's elemental magic, Adele's destructive magic, Altamisia's time magic, and Renoa's healing magic. But Squall can do all that. In fact, everyone in the party can. So what's so special about it? The magic that Squall and the gang use compared to the sorceress's natural magic is called paramagic. Paramagic is a type of magic that can be used by regular humans, and it was developed by Dr. Odine. Now, we know who Dr. Odine is, I don't have to worry about describing him, but his contributions to the game's plot are actually far more than I realized, so I will discuss that. First, as a monster researcher, Dr. Odine discovered the existence of guardian forces. Dr. Odine would later go on to work with an unnamed sorceress to develop a device that would allow humans to use paramagic, and that can be increased in effectiveness when paired with the guardian forces. This is what we know as the junction system, a device which allows people to filter one of the 32 different forms of magic from locations or entities, which they then can use in battle or to improve their abilities. Dr. Odine would go on to be hired by Sorceress Adele to help research and develop portions of the Lunatic Pandora, which Sorceress Adele was hoping to use as a weapon of mass destruction in her war with Galbadia. Dr. Odine's research into magical powers would continue on, with him being the one to tip Sorceress Adele off to the existence of Ellen in the hopes he would get to study her if captured. Dr. Odine would later help Laguna, an Astharian resistance, overthrow Adele and trap her in the Adele's Tomb cryogenic seal. Dr. Odine would then spend the next few years making trinkets, such as the Odine bangle Renoa tried using on Adia back in Delling City, and continue various research, with one of his experiments leading to the drying up and extinction of all life in the Great Salt Lake next to Esser. One more of Dr. Odin's contributions are revealed after the gang meet with him and discuss Altamisia, and that is the junction machine Ellen, which was based off of his research of Ellen when she was kidnapped, and replicates Ellen's brain waves to send a person's consciousness into different time periods. This is what Altamisia is using, along with her natural time manipulation magic, to possess other sorceresses with the goal of time compression. So now, how does this knowledge change the whole time compression scenario? Well, going back to sorceresses inheriting powers through embodiment, while the powers a sorceress inherits are weaker than those of the sorceresses they inherited from, there is no limit to how many times a sorceress can inherit powers. Meaning, a single sorceress can inherit the powers from multiple other sorceresses, thus making them more powerful than any before her. Altamisia isn't using time compression just because she wants to be the ruler of all time, which is what I always believed. She wants to inherit all of the available sorceress powers into herself, thus making her the most powerful of all sorceresses, which will allow her to be the ruler of all time. The thing is, even if this were to happen, she wouldn't be the strongest sorcerer of all time. We had discussed already how sorceresses receive their power from previous sorceresses. So by that logic, there had to be an original, right? Well, there was. And that sorcerer's name was Great Hyne. After 20 years of playing Final Fantasy VIII, I don't recall the Great Hyne being mentioned in game at all. And yet, through my research, I was able to find the times he was brought up in the story. The Great Hyne is described as a deity that is responsible for creating both mankind and the sorceresses. There are many legends and stories about him in short stories, the Final Fantasy VIII Ultimania, online databanks, but we're just going to focus on the two stories that appear in-game. The first is a tale of the Strong God, told by the old man who lives next to the Dinchs in Ballantown. Long, long ago, when this world was just made, there was a strong god called Hyne. This god was very, very strong, but after fighting a lot of monsters, he became very tired. So he had people like you and me to do all the work, and the god went to sleep. However, the god was very surprised when he awoke, surprised that there were so many people. Hyne decided to reduce the number of people by taking away the children. Of course, everyone was scared then too, and so the battle against Hyne began. Even though the people were small, they all got together and finally cornered him. Hyne didn't know what to do. Out of desperation, he gave half of his body to the people and ran off with the remaining other half. Well, he was a god. Anyway, it turns out Hyne tricked the people. The half that Hyne ran away with was the half that had the stronger magic. It might be close by, actually. It might even be watching you. Not entirely convincing and definitely vague, there's a much better version of the story told on the White Sea Ship later in the game, and that story is called The Legend of Vascaroon. Once upon a time, there was a person named Hyne. Hyne was the ruler of the world. He became lazy and decided to make a tool to make his life easier. Hyne made a neat tool. His tool could make more tools by itself. Soon, there were a lot of tools in the world. These tools were actually people. When Hyne woke up, he was surprised because there were a lot of people. Hyne wanted to reduce the number of people and use magic to burn up a lot of the small people. The small people were children. The people cherished the children very much, so the people rebelled against Hyne. Hyne used powerful magic to fight them. The people couldn't use magic, but they had wisdom. Eventually, Hyne began to lose the war because there were too many people to fight and they were getting smarter. Therefore, he decided to make peace with people by offering them half of his body along with his powers. Hyne cut his body in half and gave the people half as he promised. Then another war started. People began to fight over the power Hyne offered them through his body. This war lasted decades. Finally, King Zabalga and the Zabalga tribe emerged victorious and demanded Hyne's body half to get its powers. But the body ignored their commands. Then Vascaroon came to the rescue. He appeared before the confused Zabalgas and revealed to them that Hyne's body half was corrupt and possessed no real power. The body half was actually Hyne's cast-off skin. The Zabalgas were angered by this truth and decided to destroy Hyne. The Zabalgas never found Hyne. People began to call him Hyne the Magician and continued to hunt for him for centuries to come. So fun fact, the story of Hyne, you know, giving away his foreskin to the villagers and they're thinking it's magic and all that, that's actually a reference to Final Fantasy III, where there's a boss in there who's a skeleton magic user named Hyne. I mean, there's a lot of references to other Final Fantasies. That could be a whole other video. But for now, let's keep the... So if Altamisia is successful in gaining all of the sorceress powers via time compression, she will literally be made a goddess. Which then makes Final Fantasy VIII perfectly fit into the JRPG stereotype of ending the game with fighting God. Altamisia's plans are made far more clear in the original Japanese versions as opposed to the translated versions of the game. In the original version, it is explained that Altamisia wants to assimilate all of creation into herself then use her sorcerer's power to recreate everything according to her desires, and that this will involve humanity's very existence being absorbed, causing agony as they are torn apart physically and mentally, with their final moments being having their memories fade away with them, unable to do, think, or feel anything. So with all this info now, the game actually does legitimately make a bit more sense. And we have other information to fill in further gaps. So what does this all mean? After all this, what does it mean? We started by wondering how many sorceresses can exist at any one time, and discovered that while we know of three active ones, there is no definitive limit. During research, I also discovered facts like the Centra civilization built the gardens, there was more than just the one sorceress war, Quistis was abandoned by her foster parents, Seifer based his fighting style off of the movie that Laguna starred in, and that movie was named Zephyr, etc., 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 more useless facts, etc. So before we go down the deep and twisting rabbit hole of trying to add context and make sense to literally everything in Final Fantasy VIII, we will instead just call it an end to the video. I hope you truly learned something from this. I hope it makes the game feel fuller to you, more lived in, more sensical. I love talking about games I love, obviously, and I love learning about them, especially all these years later. Like, that's just, wow, that's huge to me. But with that said, I thank you all for watching. Please throw out some comments down below if there's any other facts that you know of, or because like I said, there's just so much apparently I missed, like so much I missed. And finally, I just want to say I hope you guys are fine with me doing other games now. Everyone seems to think I'm the Twisted Metal guy. No, it's just, that's how it worked out. But like, let's do other games now. You know, I don't know what we'll do next time. Maybe we'll do Rayplay. That has a lot of lore and nuances in it. Till then, have a good one. Thank you for watching. Bye-bye. And that's the Sorceresses.
Gotcha.
Did you know any of that was in the fucking game?
No, man. Like, no. I just...